You go back to the book of Leviticus, chapter 16 and verse 10. Now, chapter 16, verse 10, to save time, let me tell you what those two verses say, verse 6 and 10. It says in verse 6 and 10 that on the Day of Atonement, that the priest will have two goats brought to him and one bullock. Now, these two goats are brought to the high priest. Now, watch this. He has one goat over here and another goat over here. One goat is the scapegoat, and the other one is the sacrificial goat. But what the high priest will do, he will cast lots. And as he casts lot, the lot will fall on the goat, on the scapegoat. And then what the high priest does is, he has a scapegoat on his left-hand side, and he has a sacrificial goat on his right hand. The high priest will lay his hand on the scapegoat and speak the sins of all the nation upon that scapegoat. And then after he does it, he takes a red ribbon, ties it on the horn of that goat, one half of it, the other half he will tie it at the temple gate. And then they will take the scapegoat and they will go a little distance, they used to do it then, and they will let go of it so that some wild beast will kill it. But when they take a little distance, and when this man will come back, he'll turn and look, this goat follows him. So he said, why should curse follow me? So they decided now to push it off the cliff. So they go and push it off the cliff. It falls down, either dies as it falls, or some wild beast will come and kill it. Now, as soon as that happens, this man comes back and declares to the priest that we pushed the scapegoat off the cliff. Then the high priest will look at the temple gate. And when he looks at the temple gate, the red ribbon that was put on the gate now automatically turns white. No one bleached it. It was by itself turning white. Now, when it turned white, he declares it to the nation over there, your sins are forgiven. It's covered till the next year. So that's how they know it. Amen? But ever after the Lord Jesus Christ died in 30 AD. Now, we all understand that the temple was destroyed in 70 AD by the Roman emperor. Titus came, destroyed the temple, destroyed the full city. The temple is not existing. But from the time Jesus Christ died until 70 AD was 40 years. Now, for 40 years, ever since from the death of Jesus Christ, that red cord never turned white. The reason why it never turned, I mean, it baffled those guys. They never understood why, but we understand why. And the reason why it never turned red is because Jesus Christ was our scapegoat. Jesus Christ took our curse upon himself. And so since he's taken our curse upon himself, the scapegoat is no more needed because Jesus Christ became our scapegoat. I want to tell you something else. In the book of Luke, in chapter 4, Jesus Christ was tempted for 40 days. After the temptation, he walked straight to the synagogue. And when he walked straight to the synagogue, the scroll was handed over to him, and he opened it to Isaiah chapter 60, and he read the first four verses. Now, when he walked in, listen to this, when he walked in and when he took the scroll, or took the book, and he's about to read it, that was exactly on the Day of Atonement. Something happened after he read it, closed the book, and gave it back. Then he said to them, At this day, what I read is fulfilled in your ears. This is the acceptable year of the Lord. Now, the moment he said that, everyone got agitated, and what they did was they ran after him. And the Bible says Jesus Christ walked a little distance, and guess what you think they wanted to do to him? Can somebody tell me? Push him off the cliff. When was this? On the Day of Atonement. To push him off the cliff. So he was a type that day, he was a type of the scapegoat that moved, and the people wanted to push him off the cliff, but he walked through them and disappeared. Amen. So now that ribbon did not turn red, and those guys were confused and wondering why it never turned red. Jesus Christ was our scapegoat. Now, furthermore, what also happened in the temple over there, once again, baffled those fellows, the priests over there, because they had, I think I told you this last week, I'll repeat it again, they had the seven lampstands, the menorah. Now, this is what they had in the temple. What the priests will do, this is fantastic. I need to repeat it once again. The priests will put out four lights in the lampstand. Now, the last light over here won't be put out, and these two will not be put out. Okay? This is a teaching by itself, why two lights are not put out. These two will not be put out. But four is put out over here. In the night, the priest will come, or late in the evening, he would come, take out this particular light, which is burning. This is called the Western Light. Okay? It's also called the Everlasting Flame. He will take this, and he has to light the other four that is put out, and put it back over here. But when Jesus Christ died, for the next 40 years, this light never came on. Even if the priest would light it, it'll never light. And the priest is all confused, and this is something very big for them. Why is this lamp not lighting? Now we know, they never knew it. But we know, because it was not put out, simply what happened was, it changed location. From where it was, now it came into you and to me, because Jesus Christ said, he said, I am the light of the world. Amen. This is what he meant. Then he says, now you are the light of the world, because this light that was here that represented the Lord Jesus Christ, he came into our lives and we became the light of the world. Wow. Fantastic, isn't it? Now, another thing that we also need to know, that these lights that was put in the temple is on a hill. The rebuilding of the temple has started once again. Now that's where it was. It was on the hill. And the light that came out from the temple, from the crevice over there, when it came out, it was greater than any other light around over there. Amen? It superseded all the light. Now Jesus Christ told you and me, he says, you cannot take a light and put a bushel on top of it. You need to be put on a hill so that everyone will see that light and they'll glorify God. Now, there's no more temple in Jerusalem, but the temple of the Holy Ghost is here. In this temple, this light has come. Amen? This is fantastic. We go on. Are you blessed this morning? Hallelujah. The miracles, that is called the miracle of Jerusalem Talmud, the Western light that went out. Now, the first Yom Kippur is celebrated in Exodus chapter 32 and verse 30. Let's look at it. Exodus chapter 32. And verse 30, let's read that. This is the second time when Moses is going up to Mount Sinai, and the second time when he goes up, he goes for 40 days. The first time he went up for 40 days, and when he came down, we all know what happened. He broke the tablets over there, and they never received the law. He goes up the second time, and he stays over there for 40 days, and he receives it, and he comes back. Now, 40 days, once again, in the book of Luke, in chapter 4, verses 1 and 2, it says Jesus Christ fasted for 40 days. Now, when Moses came down after 40 days, it was exactly on the Feast of the Day of Atonement. When Jesus Christ fasted for 40 days and came into the synagogue, it was on the Day of Atonement. Can you see a parallel over there? I got a big list. I'll give it to you one of these days. What happened on the Day of Trumpets? Well, let me tell you at least two things that happened on the Day of Trumpets. On the Day of Trumpets is exactly the same day in which God breathed into the lungs of Adam the breath of life. Amen. On the day of the Feast of Trumpets is the very same day in which the ark rested on Mount Ararat after the flood water receded. And I can preach a full message on just on these two things. But let's move on. Chapter 23 of the book of Leviticus, verse 24. Let's go there. Chapter 23, verse 4, is when the Feast of Tabernacles is celebrated. Now, we all know that the Feast of Tabernacles is the last feast out of the seven feasts. Now, on Mount Sinai, this is on the third month, the month of Sivan, according to the Jewish calendar, is the month of May or June, is when the day of Pentecost happened in the book of Acts. But when you go back, almost 2,000 years prior to that, is the very same day in which it was the day of Pentecost, when they celebrated the Feast of Pentecost. Now, it is on the same day, the third month, marking 4 months after that, which is the seventh month. On the seventh month is the Feast of Tabernacles. I'm almost coming to a close. What is the Feast of Tabernacles in short? The Feast of Tabernacles is, why were they asked to celebrate tabernacle? The reason why they were asked to celebrate tabernacle is because for almost 40 years, they wandered in the wilderness. Now, in the 40 years that they wandered in the wilderness, every year they celebrated tabernacles. And then the Lord said, finally, you will celebrate the actual tabernacle when you get into the promised land. But these 40 years, they celebrated tabernacle. And at the same time, the Lord said, you will build a tabernacle for me. And the Lord was tabernacled in that tabernacle. So 40 years, tabernacle was celebrated. The Lord himself was tabernacled in the tabernacle of Moses, along with his people. But when I go to John chapter 1 and verse 14, this is where we need to understand something important. John chapter 1, verse 14. This is what it says. And the Word became flesh and dwelt amongst us. Listen, church. In the Old Testament tabernacle, the Lord dwelt in that tabernacle. Dwelt amongst his people. Now remember, he told Moses, he said, Moses, I want to dwell amongst you. And in order for me to dwell amongst you, you must make me a tabernacle. And when you make me a tabernacle in the Holy of Holies, my Shekinah glory will come, my presence will be there, and I will dwell amongst the people over here. Now that's in the Old Testament. But when we come to the New Testament, it says over here, the Word became flesh and dwelt amongst men. Now that word dwell is in the English Bible. But the actual word is, he was tabernacled amongst men. Amen? So today we understand that we, the church, have the Lord Jesus Christ who's tabernacled himself in us. The Old Testament, they celebrated tabernacle not knowing that the day is coming and the day has already arrived. We, the church, have the Lord who the Word became flesh and tabernacled himself amongst us. Now listen to this. The day is coming in a short time from now where the Lord said in his word, we'll go to Zechariah chapter 14. He says in his word, he says, for 1,000 years we will celebrate tabernacles again. Every year we will celebrate tabernacles. Now why was he celebrating tabernacles every year and we will be celebrating along with him? Amen. When we go to Jerusalem. Amen. And that's when Jesus Christ comes and he stays there for 1,000 years. Now, Zechariah chapter 14, and I think it's from verse 16. Yes. We'll read from verse 16, in fact, till the end of the chapter, but we'll read a few verses over there. And it shall come to pass that everyone that is left, in other words, those who never fought the Lord at the time of his second coming at Armageddon, he says, those who are left of the nation which shall come up against Jerusalem, who never came up against Jerusalem, shall come and go every year, year to year, to worship the King, the Lord of hosts, and to keep what? The Feast of Tabernacles. Read the next verse. The next verse says, And it shall be that whosoever shall not come up with all the families of the earth unto Jerusalem to worship the King, the Lord of hosts, even upon them there shall be no rain. Read the next verse. And if the family of Egypt go not and come not, even upon them there shall be no rain, there shall be a plague, wherein the Lord will smite the heathen that come not to keep the Feast of Tabernacles. I'm concluding. This is fantastic. Listen to this. Why isn't the church celebrating Tabernacles today? Not many churches do it. I spoke to a pastor recently. I was trying to explain to him. You know what answer he gave me? Why are you breaking your head about all that? Preach the simple gospel. That's it. How sad. I was wanting to tell this pastor, read Zechariah chapter 14 from verse 16 onwards. If it's important then, how much more it's important for us today? In those 1,000 years, I want to tell him, buddy, if you don't celebrate Tabernacles then, there'll be no rain on you. You got to celebrate it then. You're compelled. Now, we need to understand, as Bible students, to study why we do certain things. And I'll tell you why. The reason why Tabernacles are celebrated at the 1,000-year reign, because Tabernacles is concluded in the fifth gospel, in the book of Revelation. In the book of Revelation, when the Lord says 1,000 years is over, and after the 1,000 years is over, then I will actually take full control, and then I will take over, and then once again, this earth will be just like during the time when Adam and Eve was created and no sin came. Then I will tabernacle myself amongst you forever. And when that is done, you don't need to celebrate Tabernacles then. My brother, my sister, aren't we privileged this morning to know that the Lord is opening our eyes to things that has been concealed for centuries? It's only the grace of God. No credit comes to me, but I'm a student. I'm a student of the Word. I spend quality time in studying the Word. Why? As a shepherd, I need to feed the sheep. Amen? So we've been having a good meal today. Can you say amen? Amen. Hallelujah. Well, I'm not concluding today. You come next week. There are two more important feasts that not many people know about. And these two feasts, the Lord himself celebrated, Jesus Christ celebrated. What is it? Next week. Amen. We'll conclude next week. But for today, it's concluding the seventh feast. So I gave you briefly what trumpets is, what atonement is, what tabernacle is. Why we celebrate tabernacle? This is the reason. Now, the Lord said, he said, when you come to Jerusalem, and when you come to celebrate this feast, Deuteronomy chapter 16, verse 16, shall we go to that verse? Do not come empty-handed. Now, when the Lord said, don't come empty-handed, it was not that he was wanting what we have. But rather, what he was actually saying, he says, when you come and when you bring a gift, now I'm not advocating, but for my birthday, people give me gifts. Amen? If not anyone, for sure my family gives me. So, I feel I'm appreciated. And I appreciate the people who give me the gifts. It's not that I'm wanting. But it's different with the Lord. The Lord looks down. I'm not going to tell anyone to give me gifts. In fact, that's a day I try to avoid. But the Lord says, you better give me a gift on that day. Why is the Lord saying it? I'll tell you why he says it. On the day of his feast, I go to the Lord with such joy and excitement. And I pull out my wallet and I say to the Lord, Lord, this month my salary has been 10,000 rupees, Lord. I'd love to give you 1,000, Lord, back. And I don't know for what this could be used, but I'd like to give it for 1,000. Now, the Lord does not take it from our hand. No, he takes it through people. And like we just read, that has been given to the widows. That's been given to the orphans. And the Lord looks down and says, if you've done it unto them, you have done it to me. Amen? And so that's what we do. So let's read that verse over there, verse 16. Three times in a year shall the male appear before the Lord thy God in the place which he has chosen. This is the place which he has chosen. A place which he has chosen in the feast of unleavened bread, in the feast of weeks, that's Pentecost, and in the feast of tabernacles, and they shall not appear empty-handed. Bring an offering. My brother, my sister, it doesn't matter how big, it doesn't matter how small. What really matters is the heart. And what you give right now, some widows will be taken care of. Some orphans will be taken care of. How do you like that man? I gave him a 100 rupee note. He's looking at it different directions. You'll have people that will say, I have two meals being taken care of. Or children that will say, I have something to be taken care of because of what we have given to them. If you would bless them, God will bless you. He will bless your children, and the day will come when you will lack nothing. So shall we all stand? Bless you, Lord. We worship you this morning. Give you praise. Keep worshiping the Lord. This is a sacred moment. I feel the presence of God over here. I also feel that some people have been healed this morning. Depression is lifting off. Every kind of oppressive spirit is leaving. For in His presence there's deliverance. In His presence there's joy. Hallelujah. Thank you, Master. I'm reading a passage from here, and I want you to know that this passage is connected with this offering over here. Will a man rob God, yet you have robbed me, and you say, wherein have we robbed thee? In tithes and in offerings. Therefore you are cursed with a curse, because you have robbed me, even the whole nation. Bring ye therefore all the tithes into the storehouse, that there might be meat in my house. And prove me now herewith, says the Lord of hosts, if I will not open the windows of heaven. My brother, my sister, in what you did this morning is declaring the windows to be opened. And I will pour out a blessing that there shall be no room to contain that blessing. Father, we thank you for this morning. We thank you, Lord, for the privilege that you have given to us, where we can understand what significance this day carries, O God. It's a day in which that we believe thy word says that you will come down. And Lord, we believe that you have come down, O God. Lord, you have seen us, Lord, being obedient to your word. Father, we thank you, Lord, by us doing what we did, we made this your day, O God. And dear God, we pray that even as your people have given, O God, and as this money will be given, O God, distributed, as it was just said, that even as they are blessed, in return you will bless us back. I ask you to bless thy people this morning. Bless them, O God, according to your word. You said there will be no room to contain that blessing. Lord, if somebody is looking for a better employment, and if they've been giving, Lord, we know that you have opened another door, God. Lord, we pray that marriages will take place, God. Lord, we pray this morning that sick bodies will be healed, God. Lord, we pray, Lord, that depression will leave, God. Father, we pray, Lord, every confusion and strife that remains in our homes will begin to vanish this morning. In the name of Jesus Christ, Lord, we pray that you will touch us afresh, God. We need a fresh anointing this morning. We thank you, Lord, once again for this day. We thank you, Lord, for this wonderful day. And Father, even as we return back to our homes, Lord, we know that your blessing will follow us. We give you all the praise, the glory, and honor. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the sweet fellowship of the Holy Spirit abide upon each one of us this day and always. Amen.